Church, say amen again.
Amen.
Church, say amen one more time.
Amen.
And y'all, come on, say it like you really mean.
Amen.
Amen. Isn't it just good to be in the house of the Lord?
Amen.
Just one more time.
Amen.
Let's give the Lord some praise. God is yet blessing us. Bless us even more for this evening's service. We've asked that Reverend Jones would come to us with scripture, followed by Reverend Franklin. Just say amen.
Amen.
Chapter starting about 13 verse. Reads, "For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Now then shall they call on him whom they have not believed. How shall they believe in him whom they have not heard? And how shall they hear without a preacher? How shall they preach except they be sent? As it is written, how beautiful are the feet of them that preach the gospel of peace and bring glad tidings of good things." May the Lord have blessed the readings of his word for edification of our soul.
Shall we bow our heads? Eternal God, our Father, we thank you for the service on this afternoon, God. God, we ask that you may send your latter rain, O God. God, we ask that you may send your anointing down that we may give you the glory and the honor and the praise, O God. God, I ask that you may lift Brother Fidel up, which is Minister Fidel, O God. Get in his spirit. Get in the secret place of the Most High, that he may abide in the shadow of your wing, O God. God, I ask that you may touch him from the top of his head to the soles of his feet, O God. God, I ask that you may help us to give you the glory and the honor and the praise, O God, because you're worthy of all the praise, O God. God, we thank you on this evening because you woke us up this morning and you started on our way, O God. But God, you are a true and a living God. Lord, you shed your blood on Calvary to save a wretch like me, O God. God, I ask that you may lift up a bowed down head. God, I ask that you may bring the sinner to a head, O God, to bring them to be saved, O God. God, we ask that you may do the utmost to the uttermost, O God. God, we ask that you may do the impossible, because you are true and a living God. We know that you have power and victory, O God. God, we ask that you may take over this service on today, God. We ask that you may bless every minister on today, God. We ask that you may touch every deacon on today, God. We ask that you may touch in the congregation, O God. God, we ask that you may be given the glory and the honor and the praise, O God. In these blessings, in Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Sit with us that we may be blessed with his presence. Church, say amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Our congregational hymn for this afternoon is number 248. Number 248. Number 248. It is entitled "Hold to God's Unchanging Hand." We're going to ask all to stand with us this afternoon as we lift our voices up.
baptized with water, the same said unto me, upon whom thou shalt see the Spirit descending and remaining on him, the same is he which baptized with the Holy Ghost. And I saw and bear record that this is the Son of God. Again, the next day after John stood and two of his disciples, and looking upon Jesus as he walked, he said, Behold, the Lamb of God. And the two disciples heard him speak, and they followed Jesus. And then Jesus turned and saw them following and said unto them, What seek ye? They said unto him, Rabbi, which is to say, being interpreted, Master, where dwellest thou? He said unto them, Come and see. They came and saw where he dwelt, and abode with him that day, for it was about the tenth hour. One of the two which heard John speak and followed him was Andrew, Simon Peter's brother. He first found his own brother Simon and said unto him, We have found the Messiah, which is being interpreted the Christ. And he brought him to Jesus and said, Then when Jesus beheld him, he said, Thou art Simon the son of Jonah. Thou shalt be called Cephas, which is by interpretation a stone. The Lord have reading to the blessing of his will. Bless the Lord have blessed to the meeting of his word. Verification of my son. This is my only son.
We're going to have A and B selection from choir and music department from Christian Faith Missionary Baptist Church. And A and B selection. And following that selection, we're going to have an introduction of a speaker done by Pastor Brown. Church, say amen. Pastor Brown to come forward and introduce our speaker for this evening. Church, say amen.
To other ministers. Amen. I do not know their all name. I would just simply say to all of the warriors, we reach again, brothers and sisters, in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. I'm so glad I still can reach you in that name. Because there's no other name that's sweeter than the name of Jesus. Amen. He said to help me, but I want to thank this pastor for opening the doors for us on this afternoon. I want to thank you for the kind words that express. Amen. You know, I said that it's just nice to be nice. Amen. So I want him to know how I certainly appreciate that. Amen. When he was saying, if heaven will be better than this, amen, we have some of the quality. To all of friends and all the brother Fernell, I gotta say Junior now, amen, because we got another Fernell. He's a preacher, but he's singing. Yeah. Amen. So Brother Horace have been a courageous young man in Christ. And I said, if you don't like more, you don't really like anybody. I had the experience once, and I stopped riding with you, Carl. But when we stopped by to get something, he knew someone. They would put a conversation on. They would go on and on, and I would be ready to go home. So I said, well, I can't stop from talking, but I don't have to ride with you. But just, that's just the kind of a person he is. Amen. He had a very unique ministry that the Lord had given to him, and I'm grateful to be a part of that. Amen. And if I bring him, let me just simply say this to you. I said to him, oh, more you don't have to worry about, because when I read the scripture, I think with Jeremiah, say, I was ordained even before I entered into my mother's womb. So you just, you've been preaching all the time in your own way. Now you just doing it over. Amen. Brothers and sisters, you give me a great privilege, opportunity to have, not only to present my good friend, but my son-in-law. Amen. We talk about many things. Amen. And you look so glad. Amen. And I can stand and say I'm proud that he's my son-in-law. I'm proud of that. Amen, amen. One that knows the word, one that talk, live what he talk. Amen. Everything, every time you see him, you always got something to encourage those who feel that can't make it. And that's what you're going to need. So just tell about it. In the form of time, I'll have to present this son, introduce the Mars, member of the Christian faith of the church, Brother Mars Parnell Jr. As he would come, I would like for us to really give him a big amen. How many of y'all really would stand on your feet and give him a big amen? How many of y'all would do that, buddy?
For a very long time. Yeah. There's a song that you hear people say sometimes. started hanging out at the parties. And it was one party we went to where they was going to jump, but they wanted to beat us up bad. They really wanted to be me and Carl and Kyle. But God blessed us. He saved us and he got out of that. Oh, but then another year came. I was down on Rush Street on the north side. And I was going to this arcade place they call it the Rubik's Room. And I was walking across the street and all I had in my mind was focused on them games. I wasn't saved. I knew of the Lord, but I didn't know the Lord. Now, as I was walking across the street, there was blacked up traffic. And I was walking with the traffic. And as I got across the street on the other side, all I saw was that door right in front of me. And when I looked on the street and the traffic that was oncoming, there was none coming. So I stepped out. And something brushed my shirt. And when I looked down, it was a police car flying by on the other side. And I just said, thank you, Jesus.
Baptized with the Holy Ghost. And I saw and bear record
that this is the Son of God. And the next day after John stood and two of his disciples and looking upon Jesus as he walked, he said, "Behold the Lamb of God." And the two disciples heard him speak and they followed Jesus. Then Jesus turned and saw them following and said unto them, "What seek ye?" They said unto him, "Rabbi," which is to say, being interpreted, "Master." "Where dwellest thou?" And he said unto them, "Come and see." They came and saw where he dwelt, and they abode with him that day, and it was about the 10th hour. And one of the two heard John speak and followed him, and Andrew, Simon Peter's brother. He first found his own brother, and said unto him, "We found the Messiah," which is being interpreted, "the Christ." And he brought him to Jesus, and when Jesus beheld him, he said, "Thou art Simon, the son of Jonah. Thou shalt be called Cephas," which is to be interpreted, "a stone."
Yes, sir.
We bow our heads in prayer.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus.
Spirit of the living God.
Yes.
You fall fresh on me.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, right
now. Father, I come that I may decrease, that you may increase. Lord, I ask you to minister to these your people. They are not mine, they are yours. And Lord, I thank you for the ears and the hearts which will come to hear. But Lord, they come with burdens, they come with circumstances, they come with situations, Lord, and they need a word from the Lord. And Lord, forsake not your people. Send a word that will comfort their hearts, that will comfort their spirits, that they will know beyond the shadow of doubt that you are always the truth and the light. Oh God, I thank you for this appointed time. I thank you for this appointed day. I thank you for the love and grace and mercy that you showed upon me. Lord, I am God worthy. And I thank you for all of those who have come, those who wanted to come and were not able to. And I thank you for this nostalgic ministry, which is yours. It's not mine. I give it to you. I give all credit and praise and glory to you, man. In Jesus' name, amen. I'm not sure what kind of preacher I'm going to be. So as you see it, that's God. I come a little worried today because I see in families there is a great disruption. There's a lack of peace and there's a lack of harmony. And it burdens my heart because y'all have loved ones who need to be comforted, who need to know that you are right. And we're praying for you, we're praying with you. And I mean with a sincere heart. Well, we find when we look out on the street, we find people who are on drugs, people who are into prostitution, people who are into gangs, people are only into every ill of society, but they have a family member somewhere. I'm afraid today my concern is that we have family picnics, we have holidays, we have weddings, and we have funerals, but there's no real concern for family. For if somebody shows up, it's okay. If they don't show up, then that's okay. And it's not the way it's supposed to be, because the house of God is built on families. It saddens me today that we can jump pews, we can speak in tongues, we can prophesy, we can just display the power of God all over the church. But when it comes to the family, when it comes to those who are closest to us, where is God? We say we have the power of God, and it should affect those who are closest to us. But it seems like to me some of our salvation is like a tornado. It hits in one spot and skips somewhere else. It hits in another spot and skips somewhere else. And that's not the way it's supposed to be. Salvation, when it hits one, is supposed to go clear through. It's not supposed to skip around. Friends and folks, we got to stop. We got to stop. We got to be concerned about family. Now, I mean, we got to be concerned when we have a funeral, because that's all fine and good. Because the loved one died is dead and gone. And he's like the spoken for itself. But now that brings a reality to us. Now what are we going to do from here? We all have family members who are into drugs. We got family members who drink and they shouldn't. And it's not to condemn them, but it's to show them that God loves them at whatever state that they are in. I think our problem with ministering to people in the family is because we don't come with a sincere heart. We come with a heart of condemnation.
Yeah.
And we say, well, you know you shouldn't be doing that.
Yeah.
And then look at us and say, well, where were you at before you got saved?
Yeah.
And I think we got to go back to grassroots. We got to pray for family as though we just care for their salvation.
Yeah.
Whether or not they ever do anything good for us, we care enough about that. We want them to be saved.
Yeah.
And that's what this scripture brings home to me today.
All right.
Because the record will bear that we all know about Peter. From the Bible, we know all about the wonderful works that Peter did.
Yeah.
We know about Peter at Pentecost.
Yeah.
We know about him preaching to 5,000. But we don't talk about his brother Andrew.
Yeah.
And the Lord wants to say to each and every one of us today, bring your brother to Jesus. You can see something in them that's a little bit strange.
All right.
And you know it's just a gift.
Right.
Now they might not acknowledge that gift. It might be a gift of evil.
Yeah.
Some people have a natural gift that people like.
Right.
And so therefore they use and abuse people.
Right.
Some people have a natural gift where they can just swindle you out your money. And we see these gifts, but we don't do anything to bring them to Jesus.
Right.
See, Andrew loved his brother enough. That once he went and he abode with Jesus, and he had a fellowship with Jesus, he went and brought his brother to Jesus. And he didn't say, well, you know, now I know that that being his brother, I knew he knew his brother's gifts. I knew he knew his brother was talented. And I'm sure he never thought to himself
that when the Lord used him and he started his ministry and he get big, he ain't gonna remember that I brought him to Jesus.
They never thought in his mind. But I'm sure out of the love and concern for his brother, he said, I got somebody I want you to meet. I want you to meet Jesus. And therefore, he didn't say, hey, come and go with me to church. He said, come and go with me to meet Jesus. And I think we get that confused sometimes because we say, well, come on and go to church with me. And that means come and meet the minister. But when we found Jesus, we didn't meet the minister all the time. When we got Jesus, we got it all by ourselves. Or somebody led us to it. I think we have to have enough love and concern for family members to bring them to Jesus.
Yeah.
And I don't mean whatever condition that they're in. Just like whatever condition I was in when the Lord brought me.
Right.
See, he didn't look at my faults.
Right.
He didn't look at my back. I didn't look at my eyes. All we look is at my soul.
Yeah.
And my soul needed to be saved.
Yeah.
And that's why my friend Michael brought me to Jesus.
Yeah.
And see, we have to be concerned enough for people before the funeral.
Yeah.
See, we got family members who are struggling with some terrible things.
Yeah.
And they are desolate and they are isolated because the enemy has them that way.
Yes,
and all it takes sometimes for us is a word of prayer, a word of encouragement. Just to stop by and say, I know I don't understand what you're going through, but I'm here to support you. I'm going to get down on my knees today. I'm going to fast before the Lord today. See, we got a superficial kind of Jesus. See, we tell people that Jesus is all that we need, but we forget we got struggles in our lives too. And we need somebody to pray us through. We need somebody to help build us up, but we forget about that sometimes. You gotta stop looking at family members as though they're playing.
Right.
They're just a little strange. Well, that's your family. Whether it's your brother, your sister. Sometimes some of us have grown up and our mothers and fathers are dead. And the only family that we got is our husband, our wives, or our kids. We gotta love them enough to bring them to Jesus.
Yes.
Because Jesus is the one who can solve all of their problems.
Yeah.
Decrease so Christ can increase.
Yeah.
See, I found out a long time ago that I've been in God's way.
Oh, no.
See, I thought I was special. Once I got saved, I thought that the heaven's doors was just going to open up and everybody I talked to was going to get saved. But it's not so. Because it's not my ministry, it's God's ministry.
Yeah.
And God is the one who's working on the hearts.
Yeah.
So I got to get out of God's way and let God minister to the hearts of the people.
Yeah.
But we gotta love our family today. My heart is burdened today because we just got family members who are just out there. Folks we haven't heard from in a long time. I talked to a brother one day and I said, well, how is your brother doing? And he said, I haven't talked to him in about 3 years. And it hurts my heart. This is a brother. And he didn't think enough to want to call. Or whatever circumstance he came in contact with, whether he was hurt or whatever, he didn't think enough of his brother to call. But we have to bring him back and introduce him to Jesus. And I'm going to tell you a little something about John. See, this scripture in John is important because of who the writer is. See, all the Gospels are written from a different perspective. And John's perspective that he wrote his book was that Jesus is the Son of God. He is deity. And see, John wrote to the Gentiles. Okay. And John was the one who they called the Beloved. So he had a special relationship with God, with Jesus himself. And he identified Jesus as Christ. Now we all know the story. Jesus asked Peter, who do you say that I am? And Peter said, thou art Jesus, Son of the living God. But see, John said it first. So John already knew the record. So now we have Andrew. And see, Andrew was one of John's disciples first. And see, you got to understand a little bit about Andrew. By him being a disciple, when he went with Jesus, he abode with him. That means he had a relationship. And it's just like what we confess. So we confess that we were born with Jesus. And that confession is that we have went somewhere. Jesus has taken us to another place that no other human being can take us before. And now we have come down. Now when Moses went to see God, he came down with Shekinah glory on his face. He had a faith. Now when we come to see Jesus, what did we come down with? We have to come down with something that's substantial enough that we want to tell somebody else about. And if Jesus didn't do that for you, then you got to go back and roll with him a little bit more. See, the writer John had a special relationship. And that's why he tells his story from a different perspective. As Jesus Christ being the Son of God. And that's why the first part of that scripture is so important, because he was there. He was an eyewitness when John baptized Jesus. And he was there when the Spirit descended like a dove. And he heard the voice, when the voice said, this is my beloved Son, I'm going to well pleased. So from all that excitement, then he went and had a little abode. I mean, can you imagine the scripture? If there is Jesus walking by, and the Spirit had descended upon him, all they can do is look at him.
Okay.
Jesus didn't say follow me. That's not what he said. The other gospel say that Jesus spoke first and told him to follow people. That's not in this account. It says he looked at him in action. What do you see?
Yeah.
And he said, we see the rabbi.
Yeah.
We want to know where you dwell.
Alright.
He said, okay, fine. Now, follow me.
Yeah.
And that's what God said to one of us one day. When we want to seek God, because God is always seeking us. It's just an appointed time, it's just an appointed day. God is always telling us that the Bible says while we were yet sinners, Christ died. So Christ is always going out. He's always going out. And that's what's so significant about the story of the tale about going out into the vineyard. And Jesus came and going out. And he went back and the man came to the vineyard. And he went back and he came to the vineyard. And that's what Jesus is doing with us. He goes back and he comes back to the vineyard. He goes back and he comes back to the vineyard. And all of this is for the purpose of us bringing loved ones to Christ. So Christ can get the glory. He can be back. He can be glorified. But we have a loved one enough to bring him. It concerns me that we have family members that we don't even talk to. We can't even speak to. But we have the love of God in us. And that came home to me now in my spirit. That I have not been as good as I thought I had been. And I must apologize. I haven't been all that I thought I was. And I got some of you who better record. If I ask somebody right now to say that I wronged them, or if I ask somebody to say I have done something that wasn't good, I'm sure I can get a few people to raise up their hands. So I can't stand there before you thinking that I'm so special. And that's why God humbles me today. But he humbles me to say we have to bring family members. I shout in prophecy. And all my gifts, I am praying that those who are closest to us are not affected by. We have to continue to go back. Now we have people on our job. We affect them. We have the neighbors. We affect them. We have people on other blocks who we affect. But we got husbands. We got wives. We got kids who have not had opportunity to see all that God has to offer with us because we haven't given to them. We haven't shown them the love of Christ. Christ is much bigger than what we represent. We only represent a small part. Because if we represent all that God has for the people, it's slow. But God loves us so much. He saved you, and you, and you, and you, and you, and you. And he's ready to save those who have not accepted him in the pardon of their sin. And I am humbled today to be in Reverend Tim's church. I've married in this church. I've shown my love in this church. And that same love is the same love that I want to give back. And I want to say, bring your promise to Jesus. You don't have a gang problem. You have a problem with your family. Gangs have replaced the family. Because they show love. They show support. That's why drug addicts will be with drug addicts. And alcoholics will be without heart. Because those are the people who show love to them. And so we ought to show that same love. The love of Christ. We got to get out of our love. We got to put ourselves aside. Because in my own flesh, I don't know how to love. And the Lord told me that. You don't know how to love. That's why he said the first commandment, which is, love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, and all thy mind. And then love your neighbors as yourself. Well, if I don't know how to love me, I certainly cannot know how to love you. So today, my brother-in-law coined the phrase last night. He said today is the beginning of the new day.
Well,
today.
Today.
It's not wait for funerals. It's not even wait for a wedding. Let's not wait any longer than today. Because the Bible says tomorrow is not promised. And remind me of Phyllis Hyman, who a lot of us heard about her recordings and the records. And she had family who went to her to present the gospel. And she rejected it. But that's okay. Because their hearts are not heavy because of what they didn't do. The hearts were heavy because she didn't have enough courage. She didn't have enough strength to go on another day. But their hearts were not heavy because they did not present her to Jesus. God is saying today. Present it to Jesus. And that's not talking about your color. That's not talking about your ethnic background. We're not talking anything about it. I say bring it to Jesus today. And I want to end with a story. Man whose mind is not on God doesn't see him. the man who's got his mind on God sees the bus coming.
Yeah.
And he makes a rational decision.
Wow.
And he understands the decision he's about to make.
Right.
And he says that if I attempt to save this man,
yeah,
I could lose my life.
All right.
I could lose my family.
My.
I could lose everything.
Yes.
But then he thinks about God. And he thinks about how God has been good to him.
Yeah, yeah.
And he thinks about the scripture that says that if I try to keep my life, I will lose it. But if I give my life, then I'll keep it. It's on a rational decision.
Yeah.
He jumps in front of the man and pushes him out of the way and gets hit by the bus. And he dies and he's killed. And the man who did not know God stands and looks.
Look out.
And he says, oh, what a wretched man like me. A man gave up his life.
Yeah.
That I might be saved.
Yeah. Now.
He didn't think about what color he was.
Yeah.
Because you know we got a hang up about Jesus.
Yeah.
Some people say Jesus is black, some people say Jesus is white.
Yeah.
It doesn't make a difference.
Okay.
What it makes a difference is on Calvary.
Yeah.
A long time ago, Jesus gave up his life. That we might be saved. See, he didn't think about the cross.
Yeah.
I mean, wait a minute, we're talking about Jesus now.
Alright.
He had been before time was. He said he was the Alpha and Omega, so he lived all the time.
Yeah, right.
He had clothed with glory. He was with the Father.
Yeah.
But he decided a long time ago.
Yeah.
I'll give up my life.
Yeah.
I'll give up my life.
I'll give up my life.
And God says today.
Yeah.
Jesus has given up his life.
Jesus.
That we all may be saved.
Yeah.
What are you going to do with his salvation? God has a call on all of our lives for sitting here today. There are some who are not here. God still has a call on their life. Don't let God's death be in vain.
Well,
because God so loved the world.
Amen.
And he gave his only begotten Son.
Amen.
Whosoever shall not perish, but have everlasting life.
Yes, sir.
And I want my mother to come sing for me. Because she is the one who bore me. She is the one who took my pain. She is the one who prayed many nights for me that I would leave this morning church. The doors of the church are open today. And God wants to know, what are you going to do with your salvation?
Salvation.
What are you going to do with your salvation?
Hallelujah!
Salvation. Thank you.
heard the word from the Lord.
Reverend Neil will come and give remarks, And after Reverend Parnell, we're going to ask Pastor Aaron Heron to come and give remarks. After Pastor Heron, we're going to ask Pastor Brown to come and share a word with us today. Give his remarks and then give the benediction. Just say amen. Reverend Parnell, Reverend Morris Parnell Sr. Won't you come?
Let every heart say amen. Is there anything to say beyond what he said? He's been the same since a child. Him and Tim, Mike, looking like he could rest the whole house. Have been grown since they were 15, 16 years old. They talk like old men. And I've enjoyed them. I've enjoyed a son who I never had a problem with. Who I could look in the eye and say what I felt.
Yeah.
He understood. So God has been good to me. I just don't have anything other than to say but to praise the Lord.
Yeah.
All those that are here, the innocent, everybody that's here, Burns next door, you come and boost me. I just feel good about it. I'm so happy. I don't know what to do. You hear me read the scripture, and I didn't see not a word. So I don't know what I said. Don't hold it to my head, hold it to my heart. Because I've been praising the Lord ever since I've known, and I've known him for some years. When he came and told me, I told him, what you're telling me, well, why don't you tell the Lord? No, don't come to hear about it. He asked me, did I cry? I said, no, the Lord called me, you need to call me. So he said, well, you mean you didn't cry about it? I said, no, I didn't cry about it. You've been knowing it all this time, and you didn't cry. So why you want me to cry? You got this feeling that you want me to shout. But the show is so good. The Lord put him in a good family. Put him with a good wife, a loving wife, a holy wife. And all that shouting on the first car, that was his mother-in-law. So you know he's in good hands. So now we took him from his mother to his mother-in-law and gave him to his father-in-law and then to the Lord. I ain't got nothing.
Amen. Y'all beg my father this evening. We're going to ask that Pastor Griffin to come as well and share a word with us. That is Pastor Griffin. Just say amen.
The Lord bless you and keep you to our presiding officer and to Pastor Brown and to your other priest brethren on the roster. It's good to be here and to Mark. The Lord bless you. I rushed my afternoon service this afternoon in order to get here. All right. And I canceled night service in order to stay here. There are not too many folks that I canceled night service for. When I told Kendra to go night service tonight, after the afternoon service, and I said there will be no night service, they said the heat must have got to our pastor. But I told him, a good friend, a good brother, preaching his first sermon, and so I told the churches they've been kind all day, and vacation Bible school all week, and another week of vacation Bible school to go, and I said, I'm going to let you all have the rest of the night off. And they start shouting all over again. So I got it just in time. You was getting up, but I want to encourage you to keep going. But let me say this as I go to my seat. It's not going to be an easy struggle. God has some things that you got to go through. This is a good crowd now. The next crowd, the next sermon is going to be half of this. And the sermon after that is going to be half of that one. And then the next crowd is going to be your wife and children. Then the next crowd will be you in the bathroom mirror. But before I ever get discouraged, just keep on preaching. Preaching is called, the calling is the preparation. Study to show thyself approved. You just keep on, don't wait till you're asked to preach to start writing a sermon. You just keep on writing, when it's time to preach, you already got it. You already. Last, obey your pastor. Respect your pastor. Don't ever take a preaching engagement outside without first talking to your pastor. Check with home before you leave home. I got four now, all of them are older than me and two pastors. And before they preach, I don't know what they're going to preach. And they don't know how they're going to preach. Then I ask them why you're going to preach. What I'm saying? It's the Lord that calls you. And as I go to my seat, and I tell all of my preachers, and I tell preachers when they preach their first sermon, that God called you to preach and not entertain folks. Preachers don't climb, and climbers don't preach.
Church, say amen again. Amen. You say amen, that means you're not part of the church.
All right.
I have heard a powerful message this afternoon. Coming from a young man who's just trying on shoes. I was amazed at the power with which it was delivered, and I was amazed at the understanding. A couple of things I want to say to your parents. Number one, Dad Martin, I know you're proud.
Yes.
There's going to come some time, though, that he's going to want to call him. There's going to be some time that he's going to want to call him. Because he's going to have some things that he needs to say that he can't say.
That's right.
And he can't say them to you because he respects you too much. To the mother, I know you're proud. I just want to say to you, if you understand it when I say this, this is another part of your testimony.
Yeah,
all right. Kind of reminded me of a few years ago when she sang at my trial song.
Yeah.
You making that happen. That's all right.
Yes,
this young man,
bless you.
The crowd ain't gonna always be his beat. I know. You ain't gonna always hear somebody say, amen. You're not going to always see a smiling face look back at you.
Yes, sir.
Sometimes you may not see anything. Sometimes they may not like what you have to say and they won't run you out of time. The only thing I got to say to you is whatever you do, preach the gospel.
Yes.
The gospel does two things. It draws people and it sends folks.
Yeah.
Always preach the gospel. And when times get tough,
yeah,
don't ever forget.
That's right.
Where you grab all of these.
Yeah. Yes, sir.
God bless you.
Bless you. I certainly would not hold you long at all. But I just thank, I want to thank, amen, Reverend Burns for this courtesy. And I was always trying. told by my mother and father, when somebody be nice to you, they just deserve for us to give them a big hand because he's been nice to us. Is that right? Come on, let's give him a big hand.
I promise you. We just had some special time. I thank the Lord
the doors right, to allow me to come forward. I thank you, Trustee Ward, for just even thinking about it. I just thank, first of all, I'd like to thank Christian Faith. I'd like to thank the choir. Y'all know y'all sign. It's not every day that people have a lot of good things to say about you. And I am the room's here with my cousin John, my sister Martha Fett, cousin Sheen, Meg, she's over there. I'm Mary, Pat, Robert, Lowe, Steve, where's Harry? I ain't got anything to do yet, I'll sit down. Harry, his wife, I mean, I am just blessed to have family members. Jesus Harrison, I'm just blessed. I truly am immensely blessed. If I never preach another engagement, if my life ends tomorrow, I am blessed. I am truly blessed. And I hope that the Lord used me in a way that puts him on your heart. Because the Lord knows he made my heart heavy. And I really didn't like it because I wanted to say, Lord, is this the ministry that you have for me? That I would have a weeping ministry. Something that would really hurt my heart. But he gave it to me and I gave it to you. And it's the responsibility of you to do with the information that he gave you. God just wants to know that he loves each and every one of you. He knows exactly where you are. Exactly where you are. And last but not least, well, I got a couple of them here. My grandma's in the back. She showed started this ball a long time ago. And she told me when I was 13 or 14, that the Lord's going to call you to preach. And I sure didn't like her when she said that. I ran. Every so often she come back and say, boy, what you gonna preach?
All right.
She said, what you gonna preach? And I go see her sometimes and she just said, what you gonna preach? And I thank her for her vision because it was her conversation. And she didn't see it because I was her grandson. She said it because she saw something in me from the Lord. And when I asked her the question, she threw the question back at me. And she said, don't you know what the Lord told you to do? He said, well, I ain't really sure. And she said, why not? You sure about everything else you want to do? Why not that? And every time I throw the ball back in my court because I wanted her to affirm my call, she threw it back in my court. And finally she said, you know what? The only thing I can tell you is what the Lord told you. And you know what the Lord told you. So what are you going to do? At that point, I had to contemplate, and I knew that this was it. This was the new day. I'd ran for it long enough. I'd seen it long enough. And I decided I would surrender. And I knew what it meant. It was going to cost us. But when I gave up all of me, I got all the Christ. So I didn't lose anything. I mean, when you give yourself to Christ, he gives you all of himself back to you. So you can never lose. You can never lose.
Yes, sir.
I got two sisters here who are just so proud of me. I don't know why. They love me so much. I mean, in spite of our fusses and our fights, despite the fact that sometimes we don't call each other when we should, we just don't get together. Their love for me never goes anywhere. And I know beyond a shadow of a doubt that no matter what I need, all I need is to get on the phone and call. And if I don't have enough prayer, they will send more prayer. They will do anything in the world for me. And that's not all the time that you see sisters in me. And they don't always criticize. But I'm just this happy that I'm your brother to my mom. Yeah, to my mom. Uber. Thank you, mom. Thank you for being my friend. Thank you for being somebody that we talk to.
Yeah.
Thank you for your mother.
Yeah.
Thank you for your friendship.
Yeah.
It means a lot. Yeah. See, mama can say stuff to you.
Yeah.
But can't nobody else.
Come on, man.
Yeah. I mean, daddy loves you. And you know your father loves you, but mama said.
Yeah.
And my mother has called me words of wisdom or just to say,
yeah,
I'm proud of you, person.
Yeah.
And don't forget the fact that I did something wrong with her last week. I made her mad. I didn't come back when I said I was. I didn't do what I could have done, but she still thankful for God for me just being her son. And sometimes in the world, things be cold and be cool. And sometimes you're trying to find your way, God. It seems like God just turned a deaf ear. That a mother would call you up on the phone. Because it's not mother, it's a sister. It's a friend, it's a cousin, it's a father. And that's the extent, that's the extended family. It's everybody. It's just not one person doing one thing. It's everybody. Everybody on the outside. Because who you don't talk to, I might talk to. And it goes on. We ought to check on everybody to make sure everybody's okay. It shouldn't be a dramatic situation, something that takes place before we decide family is important. And that's the burden of my heart today. But it's not going to go away. I know it's not going to go away. Thank you, Jim. I am just so proud to be here today. I really thank you for my father. You have a strong personality.
Yeah.
With a quiet spirit. And a heavy belt. He told me a long time ago, he said, if you have, go to jail. Get yourself out. That's not right. I was like, whoa, that's kind of wrong. I mean, I can call him. He said, no. If you go to jail, get yourself out. And then years later, he told me,
yeah,
the purpose behind what he said was,
yeah,
if you see, if you wind up in jail,
yeah,
and you will always wind up back,
and
if you never put yourself to bed, then you never have to worry about it. And I knew that if I got that tech point, he would come and get me. But he always put it on my mind, no matter where I went, where I went, if I got in trouble when I went to jail, he wouldn't come. Exactly what's on my mind is, well, I'm not gonna run with that. So when trouble started, if I get out fast enough, I left. Because I knew Dad said he wouldn't come. But it was out of love. My mother told me a long time ago before I got married, she said, if you ever leave, don't come back. She told my wife, my fiance at the time, no matter what happens to you and him, y'all be at home.
Yeah.
That's a nice quote, it's true. And it's like, no, because you're a man. And you got responsibility. And you cannot be responsible if you keep coming back to me. So I'm going to make you back. You don't have to do it on your own. Now, you know all the moments and days, the minute you get in the picture, you pick up a phone and call. But it's just the idea that they gave me sound wisdom and advice.
Alright?
To let me know I can make it. All the road is gonna be hard. I'm not gonna like all the rules and all the conditions.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm gonna make it.
Yeah.
And in my closing, I praise God for all of you.
Yeah.
I pray that you receive special gifts from the Lord today.
Yeah.
I pray that where there's healing, you be healed. Where there's reconciliation, you be reconciled. Whether there's forgiveness, you forgive. Whether there's love, you love. I think sometimes we listen and we don't receive.
Yeah.
And we have to start listening to our heart. And that's what spiritual heart, not what flesh is. And we have to understand if somebody says they're in pain, it's pain. And if somebody says it's confusion, it's confusion. And we might not always understand. But we must support. Because God forbid something would happen.
Yeah.
And then like all the jewels you see,
yeah,
tear them out of the casket, drag them down
don't